Once your group has a pretty good grasp of the properties of formulations, why pesticides are formulated, what the pros and cons of different ones are, then there's a bunch of other things you can use to build on that information. One is about tank mixing and incompatibility. Many times you will have a group of clients, be they corn farmers or golf course superintendents, that want to apply several products to the cornfield or to the fairway. And rather than make three trips, they want to make one. But in order to do that, they have to put three products in the tank. And those products have to basically play nice or it isn't going to work right. And many labels give you some support about that. One thing that I'll do when I'm preparing to teach about incompatibility is I'll have sample labels that the people would use, and I will ask them, number one, to find the instructions about compatibility, proper mixing, doing a compatibility test, and vet them as to whether they find them helpful or not. There are some labels that are quite helpful and tell you what products they do mix with or what products commonly cause problems. There are other labels that are unfortunately pretty skimpy and maybe make reference to a compatibility chart, which very few exist, or refer you to your extension agent or educator. And it's a reach to expect those people to know every single possible combination that every kind of pesticide applicator in their area would use. So, back to the point, if they can have their hands-on experience with some labels and find this information, it's real helpful. But it also helps, I think, if you can use these common materials to show what happens when materials aren't compatible. It'll give folks something to hang their hat on when they're trying to do these tank mixes or do these compatibility tests in preparation for making a tank mix. Now, here, for example, would be a physical incompatibility. There's plenty of instructions, and you can reference your resource materials from Penn State for this, but a good example that I'm not going to show is oil and water. If you pour corn oil into water, it's not going to mix, it's going to layer. If you put a little dishwashing detergent in there and shake it up, you can kind of keep a mixture somewhat uniform, but the minute you stop shaking or let it stand, it's going to layer back again. So that would be an example of physical incompatibility. Another one would be this. I'm going to take some strong tea, which is a solution, and I'm going to add some lemon juice, which a lot of people do to their tea. And then add cream. And if you do this, you need cream or whole milk at least. You can't get by with the skinny stuff. Okay. All right. And when you mix these materials, you no longer have a clear solution. And if you look at this closely, you'll see that there's clots or lumps forming in it. And that would be very difficult to spray without plugging nozzles. It would be very difficult without agitation to keep it uniform. And here's some that I mixed up several hours before, and you can see what's beginning to happen. In your resource materials, you'll find many examples of both physical incompatibility and chemical incompatibility. Here's a cheap, inexpensive way to demonstrate chemical incompatibility, and also play on what students have probably learned in biology class if they ever did a starch test. Now, we're going to start with a weak suspension of cornstarch. And you can tell it's a suspension because it's cloudy. And also a weak solution, a true solution of iodine. Now, one would think if you mix cloudy white and clear orange, you're going to get a lighter orange. However, if you put these together, you're going to find that's not the case. And in this case, you've got something purple. And what you have, you don't know. In fact, like I said, this is the positive test for starch, iodine onto starch. But the fact is that as an applicator, you could clearly see you don't have what you started with. You don't necessarily know what you have. Could you spray this? Certainly. Would you want to? I wouldn't, because I don't know what I have, and I don't know if it has the same properties as what I intended to apply. Will it have the same effect? Will it burn up the plant? Will it work at all? Will it affect the insect or disease I'm trying to control? Who knows? So this is an example of formation of a new substance, which is indicative of a chemical change, which tells me I probably don't want to fool with this stuff. Okay, as a suggestion, if I were you, I would use three jars rather than pour one into the other. If you use the three jars, the third for the combination, you can compare what you started with to what you end up with. Same thing for the precipitate formation and the physical incompatibility.